Hi, Assalamualaikum. Again, we are going to continue our chapter one still in introduction to investment. Okay, so we are going to take a look on investment goals, process and constraints. So investment goals first. Okay, so investment goals, we have a few types of goals, whether for short term, medium terms or longer terms. Okay, these investment goals actually depends on the purpose of the investor himself. Why did he invest the money? For a short term, it might be useful for holidays. Okay, let's say you are planning to have a cool vacation at Aussie or Australia, for example. So you did around 5,000, for example. Okay, so you just invest your money for a short period of time and you save your money. So maybe the vacation is not going to be planned right now, but in 3 years time, so you already have the money which is you invested before. Okay, or to buy a car, let's say a small car, you need a deposit around 3,000 to 4,000, for example. Okay, so this kind of money could be used to buy the car and or to take any time off during work, especially for those who actually work by themselves, like a freelancer, kan? Dia kerja sendiri. So, bila dia tak kerja tu, duit tak masuk, kan? So, kalau dia dah plan nak having a time with their children or baby or something like that, so dia dah plan awal-awal, so they invest the money, okay? In order to be used during dia punya home vacation tadi, okay? If for medium terms refers to around 3 to 5 years. You hold the money for 3 to 5 years and you are going to obtain the profit. So this profit could be used to buy a house. Let's say in order to buy a house, you need RM20,000 for deposit. So you can use this money, or buying a boat. Or any extended or sabbatical break from the work itself. Contoh, you nak break kerja selama 1 hingga 2 tahun. So, you need some kind of money, kan? So, you need 20,000, for example. So, you already invested before. So, supposed to have no problem to tackle or to actually afford your lifestyle during that vacation lah, kalau terpaksa cuti, for example, contoh sahaja. Okay, so for a longer period of time, could be for children's education. So they actually invested the money up to 10 years, already saving the money for more than 12 years. So bila anak dia dah besar, they are going to further studies to universities, for example, dia dah ada dah some portion of money yang dia dah invested before. Or to buy a holiday house, nak beli rumah kedua, nak buat aset, nak beli rumah untuk bercuti, for example. Okay, so they use a longer investment methods lah. Ataupun for retirement. Okay, retirement such as ramai yang people di Malaysia buat adalah dengan mencarum KWSP lah. Okay, using the EPF money. Alright, some of them also, kalau untuk private sector punya pekerja, sometimes they invest the money bukan setakat guna KWSP, but also they invest the money at the banks. Okay, they buy a retirement scheme yang di provide oleh syarikat insurance. Right, so these are for the purpose for the longer period of time. Okay. Investment goals also, we can actually divide them by personal and also financial purpose. Okay. Untuk personal purpose, first adalah untuk insurance protection. Sometimes dia beli insurance tu untuk tujuan investment. let's say life insurance. Katakanlah dia adalah breadwinner ataupun satu-satunya tunjang keluarga yang bekerja. So the whole family akan depends pada dia. If something happens to him, macam mana family dia nak survive at least for a few months after dia punya death kan? Okay, so apa yang dia buat adalah they buy a kind of life insurance policy. So if anything happens to him, at least dia punya beneficiaries atau keluarga dia akan menerima pampasan, okay, from the insurance protection. Kedua, untuk provide a home. So they invest the money untuk beli rumah macam tadi. Invest the money to buy a home, whether it's the first home or second home, depends. Okay, so at least the money could be used to pay the deposit. If you are buying a home being constructed by the developer's company, of course you nak bayar yuran guaman dan sebagainya. So semua ini memerlukan duit. Okay. Ketiga, untuk emergency reserve. Okay, money itu juga diinvest bertujuan untuk kecemasan. So if anything happens to you and your family, you already have the money to be used, okay, during the emergency. Number four, education. So education yang tadilah sama. In Malaysia right now, dulu tak ada, dulu tiada, sekarang dah ada scheme SSPN yang di provide oleh PTPTN for example. So these schemes required nowadays punya students untuk your parents to actually beli ataupun kita katakan sebagai buat investment dalam scheme SSPN kan, as the main orang kata main syarat lah, syarat yang utama untuk dapatkan pinjaman PTPTN, sorry, bila you dah dapat further studies dekat universiti, right? So, it's a kind of a complementary punya scheme, investment scheme yang wajib di buat oleh your parents untuk childrens yang nowadays lah, yang sekarang kan, especially your juniors, your adik-adik dan sebagainya. So this is a kind of investment juga untuk tujuan education. For retirement, sama macam tadi, in Malaysia yang paling the most common adalah kita invest ataupun kita mencarum kita punya gaji bulanan dekat KWSP ataupun EPF yang sama, benda yang sama, right? For financial adalah lebih kepada safety of principal. So, untuk tujuan investment yang dibuat untuk financial lebih kepada kalau safety of principal, dia nak pastikan dia dapat balik modal yang dia dah invested. Okay, so itu untuk menjaga apa sahaja duit yang dia ada tu, dia nak protect the money. Kedua, untuk assurance on income and also financial independence. Kalau boleh, nak dapatkan income yang berterusan dan juga financial independence, bebas hutang dan sebagainya. So that's why people invest. Ketiga, untuk protection against inflation. Okay, saya rasa maybe you pernah dengar, bila kita simpan duit ataupun saving our money in normal savings account, kita sebenarnya tidak dapat melindungi duit itu daripada kesan inflasi. If you actually you have learned this in fundamental of finance, dalam tajuk time value of money, right? Yang mana duit yang kita ada RM50 for today, for example, tidak akan sama dengan RM50 yang kita ada dalam masa 5 tahun akan datang. Because this money kind of depreciate in value disebabkan oleh factor time value of money. So, samalah dekat sini against the inflation. So, if you invest, yes, dalam normal savings account, memang walaupun after 20 years, duit kita hanyalah dapat sedikit sahaja dividen. Dan actually that kalau you simpan 20,000 dalam savings account tu, after 20 years pun dia tak ada tak sebanyak the same 20,000 yang you should have during that moment lah, kan, selepas 20 tahun. So that's why people keep invest their money somewhere else selain daripada savings account untuk tujuan supaya dia boleh protect dia punya money daripada sudut inflation. So some people, they are buying properties. So kalau dia ada duit banyak, dia beli property atau hartanah because this kind of property atau hartanah ini adalah bersifat appreciate in value. So after 10 years, dia boleh dapat more than that lah, dapat profit, kan? Okay. For number 4, untuk liquidity portfolio, sometimes people invest untuk kecairan portfolio investment yang dia ada. Contoh, dia ada duit 200,000. So, not all this 200,000 dia guna untuk beli property. Because property adalah non-liquid asset. So, biasanya from 200,000, mungkin dia guna 100,000 untuk beli satu tanah, lot banglo, for example. So, 50,000 dia simpan dalam account biasa. Mungkin another 50,000 tu dia beli gold, emas, kan. Dia mungkin beli something yang lebih liquid lah. Macam gold dan emas, kita boleh tukar, turn into cash dalam masa terdekat. Or this another 50,000, dia invest in share dan sebagainya. For example, So, untuk liquidity portfolios dia. Dan nombor 5, people keep investing untuk tujuan portfolio diversification. Maknanya, kita invest juga untuk kita diversify. So, sama macam tadi, kita tak nak put the whole eggs in one basket. Maknanya, you letak satu, you ada 30 biji telur dan you letak ketiga-tiga puluh tu dalam bakul yang satu, sama. So, kalau bakul tu jatuh, the whole telur tu akan pecah, right? So, the same thing, kita diversify. Cuba diversifikan. If you have 200,000, jangan guna the same 200,000 untuk beli aset yang sama. So, just try to divide. Okay, the portfolio, right? Portfolio dekat sini means that satu, the whole bunch of your investment vehicle lah. Kat mana dia investkan. So, kita call it sebagai portfolio lah. Mungkin dalam satu portfolio tu dia ada invest dekat bond. Satu lagi, okay, the same portfolio, selain bond dia juga beli unit amanah. Okay, amanah saham Bumi Putera for example. Ataupun public mutual punya fund for example. Dan dan separuh lagi tu dia dah guna untuk beli properties. Ini kita panggil satu portfolio. Okay, right. So, these are all the investment goals yang selalu di dibuat oleh investors. Depends pada dia punya own personal reasons jugalah. Okay. So, this is how 7-step investment process adalah macam mana cara dia nak actually nak buat investment. Pertama, kena tengoklah meeting investment prerequisite. Adakah apa yang dia buat tu sesuai tak dengan apa yang dia nak invest. So, dia establish the goals. Dia adopt investment plan yang dia dah berkenan, dah pilih. Number 4, dia evaluate investment vehicle. Apakah investment vehicle yang sesuai untuk portfolio dia. Okay, contoh dia nak invest dalam bonds ke. Okay, dalam macam-macam lah. Okay, select the suitable investment. Construct the portfolio dan last sekali dia kena manage. Okay, so these are the 7 steps of investment processes. Okay, so investment constraints kita jumpa dalam next video.